Andrews McMeel Publishing presents Tales of an 8-Bit Kitten Collection, Lost in the Nether and A Call to Arms by Cube Kid. Performed by Michael Gallagher. Lost in the Nether. Chapter 1. Eebs was a naughty little kitten. Very naughty, in fact. He never listened to his mother. She always told him, "Don't go too far into the forest, son. It's dangerous, and if you ever see a purple light, run away. Run as fast as you can." But Eebs loved exploring the woods. He didn't think the forest was dangerous at all. No, it was an interesting place. Interesting and mysterious. He went there at least once a week, like today, along with his closest friends, Tufty and Meows. The three of them had found a new meadow to play in. The meadow was filled with all kinds of beautiful flowers. They were racing to see who could pick the most. Eebs watched Meows and Tufty fight over a lovely blue orchid. At last, Meows tripped Tufty, who went tumbling into the grass. Then, she hurried to pick the orchid before he could get back up.
"Hey," Tufty hissed, "not fair."
"Well, you never said no tripping," she said.
Tufty only flattened his ears and glared at her. She presented her colorful collection, fanned out like a rainbow.
"Look at all these flowers," she said,
beaming like the square sun.
"I guess that means I win, huh?"
"Whatever," said Tufty.
He threw his clump of dandelions onto the ground.
"It was a stupid game anyway."
"I agree," said Eebs. "I'm bored. Maybe we should just head back?"
"You can't be serious," said Meows.
Tufty stepped forward.
"We're not gonna get caught again, okay?"
"I know," said Eebs. "But..."
"Look," said Tufty. "The only reason our parents don't want us playing here is because they're jealous. They can't stand us kittens having so much fun."
"He's right," said Meows. "I mean, have you ever seen any zombies around here? The truth is, they just cooked up that story to keep us closer to home. Easier to make us do chores that way."
Eebs sighed. Maybe they were right. And anyway, the forest really was the best place to play in. There were so many mysteries just waiting to be discovered.
"Fine," he said.
"How about we go play some hide and seek?"
The other two patted him on the back.
"Now you're talking.
Yeah, that's the Eebs I know."
But Eebs had no idea how much this suggestion was going to affect him. He could have seen those dark rain clouds in the distance as a sign of things to come, or the chilly breeze that blew through the meadow just then. He didn't, though. Eebs was just thinking about how fun this day was going to be, a day of playing and exploring and misbehaving. The three kittens began their new game.
"I think you should go first," Tufty said.
"Why me?" Eebs asked.
"Because this was your idea, silly."
Eebs nodded. He didn't mind. He liked being it way more than he liked hiding, and he knew the real reason why Tufty wanted to hide. He liked sitting around, doing nothing. He was a bit out of shape and already out of breath after all of that flower collecting. As Tufty lumbered off into the bushes, Meows smirked at Eebs.
"I almost feel sorry for you," she purred. "I know the ultimate hiding spot. You're gonna be searching forever."
Eebs flicked his tail.
"I like a challenge."
A real challenge. He wasn't going to be disappointed. He waited for Meows to scamper off before starting to count. He reached 20, called out, and began the hunt. Eebs bounded through the hills, through the trees. He peeked in every crevice, every clump of tall grass. He raced up and down all the nearby valleys. But he never found them. Not even Tufty, who was normally easy to find. Were they hiding together?
Yes, Eebs thought. Meows must have felt sorry for him and taken him into her fantastic hiding spot.
He searched and searched, to no avail. Perhaps 20 minutes passed, then 30. The first drop of rain hit Eebs square on the nose. It started pouring soon after.
Grandpa said it was just going to sprinkle, he thought. This is some sprinkle,
At this rate, I'll need a boat.
What happened next sent a shiver down his spine. He walked through some tall ferns and found himself standing at the edge of a mountainous biome.
I'm on the other side of the forest.
He had never been this far away from home before. He was so focused on finding them that he hadn't paid attention to his surroundings. He was lost.
Hey, he called out. I give up, guys.
His thin voice was drowned out by the torrential rain. Even if his friends were nearby, they wouldn't have been able to hear him. And they weren't nearby. Eebs was sure of that. They were smart. They never would have gone this far.
I'm smart too, Eebs thought. I'll figure something out. I can just follow the edge of the forest. Yeah, as long as I stick to the edge, I'll end up home on the other side, right?
He paused.
But what about Tufty and Meows? Are they looking for me right now? Or are they still waiting for me? I can't just leave them. What should I do?
The rain grew heavier. Eebs began shivering. He decided to go back into the forest and look for them. It was the right thing to do. With a sinking feeling in his heart, he turned back to the mountains one last time. A flash of lightning suddenly lit up the gray expanse, revealing wolves. They were moving slowly toward him. His heart sank even deeper. If he had seen them, they must have seen him too. Then he heard a howl. His heart was no longer sinking. It was pounding wildly, jumping into his throat. So he started running. He ran fast, very fast. Eebs had always been good at running, but he'd never run faster in his life. Trees blurred past. Blind panic set in. He had no idea where he was going and didn't care, as long as it was away from those howls and snarls. Yet no matter how fast he went, the sounds stayed behind him. Wolves could run fast too, very fast. Eebs dashed into a thicket. Cries echoed through the trees. He could hear the wolves snuffling, sniffing, searching for his scent. That was when he noticed a purple glow coming from farther in the thicket. He turned away and crept closer to the light. To a kitten like him, it looked like a screen of violet water floating in the air, framed in black stone. For a moment, he forgot about the wolves completely. He didn't understand what he was looking at. He had never seen anything like this before. Well, the humans made things that resembled it called doors. But this was something different. Whatever it was very old. It seemed as if the forest had grown up around the strange object. Was this the purple light his mother had warned him of? It didn't seem that dangerous. The light glowed in a calm way, gentle even. For some reason, Eebs felt he should approach it. It was almost as if the doorway was calling to him, inviting him to come closer. And why shouldn't he? By now, those mangy mutts were just outside the thicket. Anything was better than facing them. And the light was so warm, warmer than any sunlight, warmer than the furnace he had slept on that time he snuck into a farmer's house. As Eebs drew closer, the heat washed over him, removing the rain's damp chill. Then, three wolves burst through the undergrowth. They stopped upon noticing the light. Their snarls turned to whimpers, soft whines. After some hesitation, they began growling again, their red eyes fixed on Eebs as they slunk slowly forward. He was an easy dinner, after all. Those wolves must have seen far worse than a violet glow. Eebs backed up right next to the light. Heat waves blurred his vision. He felt the light behind him, pulling him closer. He thought about his friends. He hoped they'd make it back safely. He was sure they would. Meows always knew how to find her way home. That was his last thought before diving into the screen of light. His vision became blurry, and suddenly he saw only darkness. Eebs would never be a normal cat.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.